we were talking going into the break, but let's just share this story with our guests because with our audience, because you and I have been at the Aurora Theater Shooting, obviously, and got a chance to talk to Zack Golditch about it again today after practice. He was, for anybody that doesn't know, he's a CSU offensive lineman who was shot in the neck during the theater shooting. He survived. He's obviously won college football as a starting lineman, so he's come back from it quite well, but you know that had to be a, he said there's still a special place in his heart for the four people that died. Wanted to move on from it, not dwell on it, which is why he hasn't talked about it with this season until today. But you had some involvement right after that. You weren't on duty that day. You said the next day?
Yeah, I wasn't there the night of the shooting, but I was there the next day. I got a call about an hour after it happened. I might be trying to just say, hey, we just came in about 5:30. Obviously, you heard about the theater shooting. And I was at a poker tournament. Like, you know, I had 4 or 5 years going, and I'm playing cards with my buddies, I've had a couple drinks in there, and it doesn't matter. We need some guys to be here for overtime. And so we had to go camp out about 6 o'clock the next morning. And his apartment is a problem. He's in Harvard's first year old. So while the bomb squad and the FBI and the CIA were defusing the bomb the next day, we were camped out in front of it in case anything happened. So we had about 10 or 12 rooms here surrounding
Did you guys know while you were waiting outside that it was potentially that dangerous?
At the time, we didn't realize how dangerous it was. We didn't find out about it until afterwards about how dangerous it was. But I knew actually it was too close. Knowing what we know now, obviously, we would have done it differently. But for what it's worth, it was a heck of a job to see the bomb. He's in jail. Justice has somewhat been served. I do believe in the death penalty. Sorry, but I do. And I believe he should die for that, for what he did. And my brother is a police officer in Aurora. And he was one of the first responders there. And he's one of the ones that apprehended the suspect. It's obvious to me that he's done a heck of a job with his life and overcoming that and being a positive member of society and being a police officer before. It seems like a heck of a kid. I don't know him too well, but I'd love to meet him and talk to him about it.
I think something that Zach could have done is, even when Kelly and I have been telling stories on him, and even getting back to the day after, he's talking to me, he says, most times he does have a talk, they talk, but let's make this about the people who really put the brakes on. He feels very grateful to be around his family. Like, through his neck, through his communication favor, but as you would expect, it still seems to be small about him. He wants to be a footballer. He doesn't want to be a member for the guy. He got a shot at being here, too. He's a college football player, but he's American.
That's a testament to his work ethic and his ability. There's 12 people that believe that he's been sacrificed, and he feels pretty lucky that he's alive. And so he doesn't feel like those 12 people deserve a lot of recognition. But I'm here to say that those other 50 people that we saw as well, that deserve a lot of congratulations that they're doing what they're doing, just to overcome those obstacles. Because in essence, it's easier. But when you have to overcome those injuries, and some of them are horrific injuries, debilitating injuries, losses of party to me and an ultimate sacrifice. It's harder for the families to lose that level, but ultimately,